Sup? Today, I'm going to go over a re-drum edit for you. Alright, so I'm an idiot and I forgot to charge my GoPro, so I'm actually recording the video on my phone and then the rest of the audio through the computer. But I'm just going to give you guys a preview of what we're working with here today, and then we'll dive right in. If you want me to stay, I'll be around today to be available for you to see. I'm about to go, and then you'll know for me to stay, I got to be me. You'll never be in doubt, that's what it's all about. You can't take me for granted and smile. Count on three. Not bad. All right, so I'm just gonna go top down here, kind of break down in more detail what I got going on. So a couple of things to note here also before I get started is a good majority of these samples are off of Splice. So when it comes to a lot of like Splice samples, especially like current Splice samples, they've been processed a lot in advance. So you won't see a lot of processing on like claps, snares, or any sort of like kicks usually. But first we have the original sample here, which is just chopped up from Sly and the Family Stone. So. And then I did some processing on the sample. I actually did some saturation here with Fab Filter, and then I used an EQ8 to just take out some harsh frequencies I didn't like. And then I used some compression and a utility to then like really sculpt the sound more the way that I wanted it to, especially if it's gonna be more of like a re-drum house remix sort of style. And then at the end here, I have my sidechain compressor, which is then activating off of this clicking noise here on the top. With the sidechain here, this is all based off of like the kick because it's that like four to the floor sort of deal. So the kick sample here is actually this. So the kick itself, whenever you're trying to like figure out how long you want your sidechain to go, like on the release, because your attack's going to be immediate. It's about ducking the sound, letting it come back in. So what I do is I'll usually double click on the sample and I'll look at the length of the sample here. So the sample, for example, starts to tail off about like 150, 160 here. So that's then an indicator that probably around like the 120 to like 150 range is a great release for your sidechain. So that's how I came to like my release on my sidechain, and that's what I do. So for example, I'm really focusing on letting the kick cut through in this mix or for this re-drum edit. So what I did was I found the length of the kick and then applied that to the release of my sidechain. So here I have a snare and a clap going at the same time. But I also, on like the drop section, I have a white noise stab going on as well. So that white noise is just adding that little bit of extra on top of it and filling out that sound, which is really, really cool. So if you're working on a re-drum edit, try putting a little bit of like white noise, just those stabs on top of your claps or snares. That might actually add what you feel is missing. And then here I have the percussion section. Sounds like this. I really like this part personally. It's very similar to the last re-drum edit. So I talked in my previous re-drum edit about sidechain compression. No, not sidechain compression. What am I saying? I talked about parallel compression and how I'm feeding a very compressed signal into like an uncompressed signal just to give it more width to the sound and really enhance the sound. So I did that again in this example here. So I have the parallel compressor going and I'm feeding it back into the drums. So if you want more detailed like kind of explanation on it, just go back to my first video on re-drum edits and you can find that one there. But this is the preset that I'm using for a lot of my parallel compression that I do with my percussion section typically. Another thing with this too is, I mean, you've seen that I have like standard EQs going, all that jazz. But what I do for my percussion sections is I actually add a little bit of overdrive just to help brighten up the sound even more than it already is. So I'll give you a little A-B so you can hear the difference of with and without this overdrive effect. So you can hear like that very top end of those hats is a lot sharper now, which is really good. And then after the overdrive, I also like to do a little frequency sweep, do some like reductive EQ, because sometimes when you put like an overdrive or a saturator on something, some frequencies can get really, really harsh. So it's important to go back in and then like duck those. So that's what I did there. That's why you see the frequency sweep that's going on, like that preset that I have, so I can like duck those volumes. And then I have some effects, just standard sweeps, crashes, all that jazz. Basic things, like all the stuff you would see in any sort of like other edit that I do is in there. The other thing I will say, I like took it a step further. A lot of times with these effects, they could be a little, I don't want to say like mundane, but they could just be going like right down the middle of your mix. So a good trick I saw Son Holo using, he auto pans like almost everything. So I recommend just grabbing an auto pan, throwing it on your effects, trying to add more movement to the sound. I found that it works well, gives room for a lot of things that are like going down the middle, like your kick, your snare, your clap, your main vocal. So if you're panning those things left to right consistently, it gives more room for those main elements to keep like punching through in those like re-drum edits. And to be completely honest, that's it for this edit. The main takeaway is finding the length of those elements that you want to have come through in the mix, and then adjusting your sidechain compressor that way. So on the release, that everything you want to come through is coming through in a proper way. The other things as well to take away from this is to utilize white noise when you're dealing with your claps and your snares, maybe to add a little extra flavor to things, fill out some dead space in a mix. And the other thing is to overdrive your hats in your percussion section, really enhance that high end, and then do some reductive EQ to then fix any sounds that might be super, super harsh. And that's pretty much it. Those are the three things I really wanted to cover for re-drum edits today. This edit is not done yet. This is something I've been working on the last like week or two, because I'm actually starting to DJ at this venue called Swingers up in DC, and it's all like disco house, which I'm super excited for. It's gonna be fantastic. But when it comes to like spinning disco house and stuff like that, I kind of want to have some disco edits in the back pocket, and edits that I might want to release someday. So this is the first of many that I will be working on or releasing here shortly. But yeah, that does it for today's video. Hopefully you learned something new. If you did, make sure to like, subscribe, all of that good stuff. And I'll be back next week with a video showing you guys how I make my multi-blend edits. So mashups, like with one acapella, multiple instrumentals, or one instrumental, multiple acapellas. Those multi-blend edits are so cool. If you're doing a live set, it gives you multiple opportunities to transition into different songs, go in different directions, really spice up your DJ set. So I'll actually show you guys one of my older multi-blend edits and how I went about making it. But until then, take it easy, tell someone you love them, all of that good stuff, and I'll be back soon. Yeah, I'm so excited to play this. This shit bumps, like... I'm